first full day of season 10, and if you haven't heard it already, I'm sure you will hear it a few times. I'm Caitlin, and this is Emily, and we are the co-founders of ATX Television Festival.
Well, we didn't picture season 10 of the festival happening virtually.
Well, we didn't picture season 10 of the festival happening, period.
Very true. That's a very good point. But regardless, we found that being virtual, we get to feature some shows and people that would have had a hard time getting to Austin in June. And today's screening and panel is exactly that.
Fox's new animated series, HouseBroken, is full of the most incredible comedians coming together today to talk comedy, animation, and obviously pets.
Some of these panelists have been to the festival before, like Lisa Kudrow, Nat Faxon, and Jason Mantzoukas, and some we've been wanting for years, like Clea Duvall and Sam Richardson. Someday we will have a Veep reunion.
Yes, we will.
So I guess we'll hook them virtually this year and then bring them back for margaritas and tacos next year.
Deal. But well, we also get to have our pets here today. Dexter, my therapy dog, and ATX mascot couldn't care less about any of this.
Hi, Dex. Well, with that, we should give them all the time we can and get off the stage.
Exactly. Let's bring out our dear friend and rock star moderator, Danielle Turchiano from Variety, to get it all started. Danielle.
Hi.
Hello. Is your pup with you?
Yeah, yes. I was going to say, Danielle and Madison. This is Madison. She's going to go away.
Does Madison care at all?
He doesn't know what's happening. He went blind right before your festival last year. So he can't see you guys this time. And he can only hear me because I have my headphones in. So you know, he's along for the ride. He's not the best therapy dog, I will say. So let's talk to some people who know a little bit more maybe about that sort of thing.
Great. Good call. We'll get out of your way. Have so much fun.
Thank you guys for joining us for, as they said, Fox's new animated comedy, HouseBroken. Please join me in welcoming the cast and creative team. First up, we have actor Lisa Kudrow. We have co-creator, executive producer, and actor Clea Duvall. We have actor Nat Faxon, actor Jason Mantzoukas, actor Sam Richardson, co-creator and executive producer Jennifer Crittenden, and co-creator and executive producer Gabrielle Allan. Hi guys, thank you guys for doing this.
Thank you for having us.
Yes, hello.
Thanks so much.
So I actually want to start with the beginnings of this show. I want to talk to you guys as creators about how this came up in terms of, was this we want to do a show about animals first, or we want to do a show about therapy first? How did this mix come together?
Well, it started originally with a very complicated relationship I have with one of our cats, who's permanently dissatisfied, who has many needs that have gone unmet for years, and me wishing that I could go to therapy with her to find out what those needs are so I can start meeting them. And then I started thinking about, you know, how fun it would be to be able to explore the inner lives of animals, like what they, you know, because as humans, we project so much of ourselves onto them, but what would they really talk about? What would their perspective really be? And so I had this idea about animals going to therapy with their owners, and I pitched it to Jen and Gabby, and they made the idea better by saying, what if instead of just one animal at a time, it was a group of animals in therapy together? And I was like, yes, I love that. And then we started brainstorming from there, and HouseBroken came out of that.
And you guys did this all while you were working on Veep, right? Like I heard, and tell me if this is true, but I heard that was kind of born on the set. Was it born out of the energy or the sense of humor on the set at all?
I think it was really, I was just really liked Gabby and Jen and was like, how do I manipulate these people into spending more time with me?
Yeah, it was after a table read, actually. We just finished a table read and Clea walked up to us, and because we were trying to find something to do together because we had bonded spectacularly. And it was just right out of a table read.
Well, I have to ask, I mean, because you have one character who is the quote therapist on the show, that's Lisa's character, Honey. I got to ask you, Lisa, how do you say Honey compares to Dr. Fiona Wallace?
Oh, yeah, they're very different. One's a human being and the other one is a horrible therapist.
That's a joke.
I made a jokey poo. Yeah, they're very different. I mean, even though I have to say my first instinct was to infuse honey with a little bit of Fiona, it didn't work. So that cost everyone a lot of time.
Okay. Well, I do want to talk with you guys as actors about like how you came to these roles. So maybe Lisa, let's start with you in terms of, did this role come to you, or did you say, I'm looking at a list of these characters and I want to play the therapist. I have something to say about that.
No. I was asked if I'd be interested in voicing Honey. And I just looked at, Clea Duvall created it with Jen Crittenden and Gabby Allan. That's probably a yes. And then I saw all these other people here, all their names went, but I want to work with them. Don't leave me off the list. Okay. And then I read it and just said, yeah, please, sure. Yeah, thanks.
So for all of you guys, tell me also how you came to it. Did you pick the character that you guys wanted to play? And I'm also curious about, maybe we can just go like round robin. And I'm going to be honest, I don't know if I see you in the right order that you see each other. So maybe I'll just call on you as like a little clockwise conversation. But I'm curious what spoke to you about the particular character once you were in that role. So Nat, let's start with you.
Yeah, I passed on this about six times. I really had no interest in doing it, but sort of like the way the three kind of creators came together, they were like very incessant. They really wanted to work with me. And I said, okay, fine. As long as I can play the lovable, sloppy St. Bernard chief. And I love the character of Chief because I feel like he is, sees the world how we should all see it, which is very optimistically and very simply. He eats whatever's in front of him, he sleeps and dreams incredible dreams, and it is sort of modeled after my friend when he has a bunch of cocktails and gets pretty drunk and kind of just...
Do you want to name that friend, or do you feel like that's just mean? Okay.
No, Will Forte shouldn't be, I shouldn't name his name. No, but he just has sort of a lust for life and boils it down to really what's important was just living. And so that's sort of how I came into this and what I love about doing it.
Yeah. Sam, how about you?
Being friends with Clea, Gabby, and Jen, when I found out they were making the show, I was so excited about it. And then, I got the offer, do you want to play Chico? And my character's name is Chico, by the way. I was so excited because like I'm now recently a cat person. My girlfriend moved in and she brought her cat and then we've adopted another cat. And so my life revolves around cats. So in order to the chance to get to play a cat was very exciting to me. And then also the list of everybody who's in it, there was no way I was gonna let that slide or get away from me.
Is there just like instant research with your cats now? Or is this, there's no comparison. You can't actually pull anything from their lives into Chico's life.
Oh no, it's pretty, Chico is my cat Gus, very very similarly. I mean, it wasn't written as that, but like my performance is very much Chico, and he's very similar, very dependent on me. Like he wakes in the mornings, like no matter what, if I move an inch, then he's like right on me, like tapping my face and then it's like, get up. I had to put foil on next to my bed because he likes to get on my dresser on the nightstand because he knows that I will say get off the dresser. So he does that because like, hey, I'm on here.
I feel like this is just material for season two.
Yeah.
He also does the most amazing cat sounds, I just have to say.
Yeah, it's true.
Do you want to demonstrate before we move on to Jason?
Yeah, sure.
I mean, you guys said it. You put it out there.
I'm sorry.
Sorry. We're sorry, Sam.
No, it's fine. Ooh. Like actors, the actor's studio.
Well, that's a robot cat. That's different.
Yeah. I've never been embarrassed in my life, and this is the first time. That's a cat. That's a cat.
Pretty good. Yes. I smell Emmy. I don't think there's a special category for cat acting, but in general.
There should
maybe next year. Jason, tell me a little bit about, you know, your involvement, what you found appealing. And also, I'm going to have to ask you, because I asked Lisa, can you compare Lyle at all to Big Mouth's Jay?
Oh, interesting. Yeah, I think for me, you know, I came in to this because I see Lisa as a therapist, like personally in our personal lives.
Yeah, yep.
And, you know, in a session, she said, you know, you're confronting a lot of the same issues that a character in this new show I'm working on is confronting. You might be a good fit for it. So I came in through that window because the gray one, the character that I play, is, you know, emotionally, I feel very connected to. He's a feral cat that lives with like 40 other cats in like a hoarder's home, which, you know, looks for all intents and purposes like the life that I live currently. So I found a lot of kind of emotional resonance with the character. He's, you know, he's got one eye, he's a mess. Most of his roommates are trying to kill him so that they can eat him. You know, he's unloved and really kind of unremarkable in his home life. And so I found a lot of like really juicy stuff there.
Like you, he's not fed and fully neglected regularly.
Thank you. And I'm so looking forward to our session this week, really digging in on, I gotta tell you about this dream I had. It was wild.
Okay.
No, so for me, it really was. It was, you know, are there any similarities between Jay and the gray one? I would say yes, both of them, Jay from Big Mouth and the gray one from this show, are both kind of neglected characters. They are both characters for whom their home lives are not emotionally rewarding or emotionally engaging, and that they are, I think, in terms of their relationships to the other characters in the shows they're on, they are constantly trying to figure out how to demonstrably kind of be emotional while constantly then chastising themselves as a result because they don't quite understand their emotional interior life. My ability to do that very well belies any kind of central truth about who I am.
And Clea, I mean, you do voice a character as well, the very important service dog. So what, and I feel like you're, you know, everyone's talking about the role came to them and you could have probably had your pick. So what went into your choice?
I don't really remember how that happened.
Jen does. Jen remembers.
Jen.
Go ahead. Yeah.
You were just constantly pitching great lines for Elsa. I think you wanted to be a cat because you're a cat person. You love cats. And you were always, though, pitching these really funny lines for Elsa with the perfect attitude, and Elsa's a dog. And so you had to really adjust your expectations and you went with it.
It's interesting. I'm glad you guys brought that up because the show has a good parody in terms of dogs and cats, but then it's also very inclusive with, you know, there's a tortoise and a hamster and all these other animals. How much of that is born out of the character themselves? Like, you're writing a character, you're giving it, you know, personality, behaviors, and then you decide what animal it is and have to add personality and behaviors based on that animal on top of it? Or did you go in with, you know, we want to do these particular animals because we have certain stories that work for them?
I think we started with animals, right? And then we kind of came up with characters around the animals.
I think now, at least when we've been writing season one, it's been sort of like, who do we want to come in and like mix up the group? Because like we have a raccoon who comes in and he's wild and he really threatens the gray one because the gray one thinks that he's the wild one. And so they have a lot going on, and Honey wants the raccoon to come in and shake things up because she's feeling like in a little bit of a rut. So we sort of use different animals for different purposes. We have a parrot who's evil and basically has a vendetta against Honey, and Chief loves him so much. So we just sort of, we get to use all these different kinds of animals for different purposes. It's really fun.
And I mean, would you say that there were certain things that you wanted to send up at all about, you know, the idea of therapy animals or therapy in general with the show?
Well, I think, I mean, we were big fans of therapy. I think we thought it was a really kind of easy, not easy, but palatable way to talk about human issues and sort of projecting them onto animals while also sort of exploring all the things that we project onto our animals and what they say about us and how they bring, you know, our insane personalities to the world. So we were sort of looking at it from both of those angles. Mm-hmm. And we just loved the idea of being able to kind of assign these animals with all of these different neuroses and really explore them in a fun and funny way. And like, you know, we heard this story, a friend of ours, sadly, we were working with them as a collaborator, and she was on the phone and her face dropped. Well, and we said, what happened? She said, oh my God, my son's hamster just ate the other hamster's face. And then her son was like 13 and he was wailing on the phone. And so of course, Jen and I were saying, well, that's hilarious, you know? And so
I know, I laughed, I felt bad.
Film it quick, somebody film it, get it on film. Tell him to film it. Tell your son to film it immediately.
But she said to him, when did it happen? He said, it's happening right now, I'm watching it. And it was terrible. But then we thought, how funny for that, you know, so that's how sort of Nibbles was born. And that, but then we wanted to dig deeper into like that. It was for her, it was self-defense, and it's very complicated for her. And so we just thought, you know, there are these really funny issues that come up, like, you know, Chico's neglect and what he projects onto Kevin and his kind of delusional relationship with his owner, and Nat, you know, Chief and Honey's sort of arranged marriage, and the Gray One's optimism in this horrible situation, and Elsa's kind of superior, you know, she's a fake service dog and she doesn't know it, you know. So there's just I'm just rambling. Somebody stop me. Oh my God.
You're not. Right.
No, it doesn't seem like you are at all.
And it's also, you know, just to see, I mean, you use the word palatable, but I think that's really smart because, you know, you're exploring some really important issues like the grief in the episode that the audience just watched. You know, Honey lost her friend, and we're seeing it through not only an animal, but an animated animal, which I think there's, you know, layers to maybe how much you can say and how you can say it because there's that distance. But I am curious when you are working on these stories, and not just for the writers, actors as well, like, are there things in this show that, you know, you saw yourself in, issues you had that you saw worked through that felt helpful to you?
I think for me, there's like a lot of, I can connect with the Gray One a lot because we both deal with like hairballs a lot. Like it's not like, you know, like there is, you know, every actor, you find one way into a character. And for me, it is really like finding that thing we both share. It's interesting, like to be getting into like the headspace of all of these characters is really funny to watch everybody when we're doing our Zoom table reads or stuff like that, like kind of get on board, start chit-chatting, catching up, blah, blah, blah. And then have it click into everybody instantly becoming the versions of their characters that they're going to be for the rest of it. And, you know, watching Nat just become Chief and just like all of a sudden, I feel like Nat just starts kind of like moving much more around his box, you know, and there's just like, there's an inherent kind of embodiment, even on Zoom windows, of everybody trying to slip into their characters as these animated pets, which is it's very fun to be able to populate animals because it allows for, I don't know, a little bit of just like weird physicality that I don't necessarily take on when I'm trying to do a human performance. as you people on this planet call it.
Yeah, it's weird when you're doing the Zoom, it's weird because it feels like, oh, like the
camera is almost off, like because there's, you can't really see anybody in the room, and then you just sort of let yourself go. And then you come to later realize that like, oh, everybody was watching you do this thing. That people can see you actually.
And you guys were just talking about that being for a table read, but do talk a little bit about the process of recording the voices, because we are still in a pandemic and you guys were shooting this or recording this during that. Was that also over Zoom? Were you guys all individual? How did that work and how was that different from what you guys have done in the past?
Well, we went to a studio that was safe. Okay. And Nat and I got to record together because I was in this teeny little room. And he was, but you know, with a glass door, and then I could see Nat, you know, in the bigger, better vent.
Yeah, that was part of when I passed six times and then I agreed to do it. I said, I have to be in the biggest room.
Sure. Yeah.
That was part of the contract deal.
But that's okay.
But yeah. right, he needs a space.
Gotta have room to move.
To move. But that was crucial for me. Mm-hmm. Anyway, because I mean, I got to do the scenes with Nat, and he made me laugh like every line he had.
That's very sweet.
And luckily for animation, you know, you can say a line, you can wait forever, you know, because it's being recorded separately. So I could break and laugh and ruin a scene, but it wasn't ruined.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That was great.
I got to listen to. I was very appreciative that I got to listen to Lisa's doing the three different versions of Honey.
Yeah.
Which I loved.
I did.
Well, the cast was amazing because we had to, we first started doing the table reads over Zoom, obviously, and then the records over Zoom before studios were safe to go into, because we had to get the tracks down so the animators could at least start, you know? Mm. So then they had to come back in and do it all over again and again and again and again, you know, with retakes and whatever. So, I mean, I think that they have been recording episode 101 that you guys just saw, like, I mean, for the past year and a half. So they've been incredibly patient and it's been really helpful for us because we've gotten to like hone the jokes and the characters and really like take advantage of that time to try and make each episode better and better. And get Lisa to crack up more during the records. So it was great.
Yeah, we're on like quadruple cherry at this point, I think.
It's insane. Final draft. We broke final draft. It's canary, page 1AA 4 through AB.
Big B.
Little B.
This is a very secure password.
Yeah. Yeah. You could take any line. Label and it's a phenomenal password. It's like you do line. All right, now we're gonna jump to line 46, big A, little A, FFG 2/3.
Okay.
And the alt. What? And there's an alt.
What as actors did you guys need to keep it fresh doing it that many times?
Because I never knew what we were doing. I couldn't keep track of it. So it was fresh, unfortunately, for them every time I showed up.
You have like, Lisa, you have like the disease that's depicted in the movie Memento, right? Where every morning you wake up, tabula rasa, clean slate.
Yeah, it's called being present.
And then just to go back, I mean, because you are, you know, you're talking about recording these a year and a half ago. So the decisions that you made then, though, to a degree, obviously have to stick. Because even if you're re-recording some things now, you know, your character is set. So I want to talk about what went into the decision about how to do your voice. If you were going to use your own voice versus if you wanted to add a little accent or just accentuate it in some way. And I do want to go around the horn on this in terms of, you know, what you felt was right for this character or right for you just as a voice performer for everybody. So let's start with Lisa because you're in my clockwise 12.
Okay, well, I'm not much of a voice performer, but I did try to do sort of a voice. It just wasn't working. And so, yeah, they helped me get to a successful version of what Honey's supposed to be a lot. And Clea even came in and was also there to read with me. And as, you know, creator of the show, also pitching and directing along with everyone. No, this, it was a whole team for me.
Okay.
It was fun. It was still fun.
She's instinctively hilarious. We didn't have to do anything. And the animation, the reason that you need the animators to have the voice first is because of actors like Lisa, like everybody here, and that's so subtle and the differences are so funny and weird and the way that they speak is so personalized. So having the animators be able to respond to that and make the characters mirror that or exaggerate that, it's fantastic. So I'll shut up now. Go ahead. Actors talk.
Clea?
I think the driving force behind my voice was really lack of skill and experience in voice acting. I think that in my head I was going to do a voice, and then I just don't have that skill. So it really just sort of like came out more of just like her tone more than it like changing the voice, you know. So I do. Gabby and Jen were very patient with me as I sort of figured out how to do this thing that I had never done before, and I appreciated that.
Yeah. Nat?
I would say it's not I mean, there's some subtle differences, I guess, between, you know, on camera versus voiceover, but I think it is sort of based in just kind of making a choice and, you know, what your instincts are and going from there. And, you know, luckily with this, there's little clues that you get. Maybe you see a drawing of the character, you know, and then you have these great scripts that are sort of, you know, wonderful maps and, you know, guides for you to draw from. And then it's just, I think, about kind of having fun and having communication with the writers and the creators about sort of how big or broad it wants to be, or what, you know, should it be reined in or should it go the other way? So I think you're sort of forming it with your collaborators and your, you know, the team of people that you have. To me, I feel like that's how it always works the best, you know, when everybody tries to get on the same page with something. You may try, you know, sometimes there'll be a different character that you get to voice, and, you know, it's usually just a conversation of like, what do you guys think in your head for this? And then you try something and it may not work, and then you try something else, and then maybe that's a better fit. And so usually it's just, you know, again, kind of coming to it together.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Sam?
I think for Chico, I was pretty much made him very similar to myself, but I made his voice higher. there's a benefit, though. We're talking about, you know, making choices early on with voice acting and animation. You have a benefit that doesn't exist in live action, is that when you go back, you re-record things, you know, like, so you can go back and you can learn the character over the course of a year and a half, and I'm still recording things from the first episode. And so, like, every time I go in, I know the character a little bit more, you know, and like, if you're filming live action, once you've done it, it's done. And like, you may realize in the first episode, it's like, oh, I didn't know my character was like this, but of course he was like this in the first episode, I just didn't know it. But now, with animation, you can inform those things as you go back, having the macro view, which I really appreciate. Mm-hmm.
Jason?
Yeah, I think that's actually incredibly useful tool in animation, because you get so many opportunities to record the lines again. You know, you get so many different bites at it that you really can kind of dial in a performance over time. And I think for me, the useful thing, honestly, was seeing the first image of my character. My character is like I said before, he's like a feral cat. He's got, you know, one eye. He's really rough looking. He looks like what his life is, which is fighting for scraps amongst a number of other cats, dozens of other cats who would rather see him dead. You know, like, he's in a blood vendetta with another cat in his house. Like, to me, the look of this cat and kind of the information that was in that first script, I was like, oh, okay. I think that helps me a little bit understand what he might sound like, which is just kind of me, but more ragged, disheveled, and a mess, which is a very atypical for the kind of characters I normally play.
So I do wanna, you know, when you guys are talking about getting all this information about your characters over time, obviously that's how it works in television, but you also have the opportunity, I would imagine, to shape it as well in voiceover, especially because you might throw out a line in that recording booth. Like if Lisa and Nat are opposite each other and he's trying to get her to laugh, he might throw out something that you guys as creators want to keep in. So I want to talk to you guys, Jen, Gabrielle, about how much room there was for ad-libbing. Like what were your rules? I mean, you have these great comedic players. What did you say in terms of what we wrote is gospel versus play around a little?
Well, just the first part, really, there was no room to play around. It was gospel.
Yeah, I mean.
Weirdly, the first recording of the first episode was sung gospel. the show began life as a musical show, mm-hmm. not on like a Glee or something like that, except for all gospel music.
And it was strictly just a lesson for us. It wasn't ever going to be used. It was just for us to know that they meant business.
We're in charge and, you know, keep it.
They kept saying this is a team building exercise. This is a team building exercise.
We welcome improving, but one of the challenges about animation, especially as you go, like if when we're doing the fifth round of recording the same episode. No, but is that now once it's drawn, you sort of have to, and timed, you kind of have to stick a little bit close to what's there because we're learning, you know, these retake after retake. It's a lot of work that goes into just changing their faces and their expressions just even a little bit. So while we do encourage it, of course, because we do have all of these amazing performers that are hilarious, and they definitely will throw stuff at us and we use it, but often we have to stick close to, if it's already animated, we have a little bit less freedom to improv than we would like.
But before that, they were very loose in a good way. I mean, it was not, you've got to say it exactly as written. You know, if it made sense, they were okay. It was heaven.
Everybody here has had ad libs in the show. I feel like Gabby sounded a lot like a parent, like, we'd love to, but it's a little tight. but that's not it at all. I think also when we are in real life, the table reads were so fun because of Zoom, everybody could join and it was amazing. And we took tons of notes during the table reads of things that they said.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we do want to be as collaborative as possible. And hopefully once we're allowed out of these boxes, it'll be even better because we have the best cast. I mean, it's just incredible. Like everybody is so funny. And there are a lot of records where we just use what they said and just, you know, make it work. So,
well, I guess when I'm recording, I don't let anybody improv. I think Jen does it. She's doing it. I had no idea. Anyway, well, we'll talk about that later.
Yeah. Who's more fun?
It's especially useful and fun when we do get paired together when we're recording. You know, it's harder to improvise when you're just doing your lines, but like there are episodes where like Sam's character and my character are on an adventure. So we would record, even over Zoom, we would record together. And that was, we were able to kind of, you know, do what was written, but then kind of meander off and find fun stuff and find weird fun ways to poke at each other. And that stuff, I think, you know, I don't know if it made it in, but is like, that's also a helpful way both to kind of find funny stuff or yes and what's already there, but also build characters and character relationships in real time with the other actors versus just kind of when you siloed being like, okay, these are the 10 lines I have to read today. Contextually, I might not, you know, I might've recorded this episode 8 months ago and I'm trying to remember, oh, what's that dynamic again between me and Chico? Or what is the dynamic between, you know? So it's great when you get an opportunity to play off of your scene partner in real time while you're recording. I love that.
Yeah, we both to do more of that when COVID is over. Our dream is to get everybody together to do it. It's so much more fun for them. It's fun for us. And it does kind of, you know, create this environment to riff. And that's been tricky with COVID.
So. Yeah. I mean, I imagine that also, you know, if you don't have two actors opposite each other, you have to then go back to that other actor if somebody ad-libbed something that you like, which then I would just balloons those the number of takes that you guys are talking about. And it seems like, you know, there's already so much that maybe you can't do that. You know, maybe there's a limit on how much you can record.
Sounds like Gabby really got to you.
No, I don't know. When Lisa was reading off that string, I was like, that is a lot. I never thought about it that way, like per line, you know, that you guys really take it down to each line is its own entity. Like that's, I think, something that gets overlooked a lot in voiceover is just the level of detail, the amount of times you have to finesse one line.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it felt loose. It felt loose. I mean, I don't know what I was gonna say.
Oh. Okay,
although it would be amazing if you think about, like it would be to consider recording like a live action scene line mm-hmm. by line. Mm-hmm. Like single line by single line is wild. Yeah. So, you know, so that's why like the kind of, cause it's also like, it's a group of people who are oftentimes like those group scenes, you want to feel like everybody is occupying the same space. And so when you get to do it with other people, it just really helps that kind of bouncing off of or feeding off of the energy of, or, you know, coming in on top of or undercutting. There's just so many ways to look at like to play an ensemble scene when you are able to be reactive and proactive in what you're doing.
Right.
But I was gonna say this. I mean, you know, with the animation as opposed to like a multi-camera sitcom or even a single camera one, when you're shooting, the writers get together and then they rewrite and try to improve the scene, improve the joke, and see what's better. With animation, they can do that endlessly, not endlessly, yeah. But up to the point of no return, you know, in the end, when you're at that point in the animation process. So it's every time you go in, the jokes are better, the story is more focused, and that's how it felt to me, that it was just like these great rewrites every single time you go in. So, yeah, or I went in.
I'm glad that you said the jokes are better. I wanna hear from all of you, literally every single one of you, about one of your favorite jokes from the show. I know this is putting you on the spot. I know you've been working on this for a long time and you might not remember every individual joke. So we won't call it the favorite. We'll just say one of your favorites. And whoever wants to kick this off, I can kick this off if you all need a second, because I will say this is so simple, but in the pilot that everybody just watched, just when Elsa is introducing herself and she's saying what she answers to, and then she whistles at the end, like that, I died. I don't know, I lost it at the whistle. So like something like that, which is, it's character building, but it's obviously also just, we're having a real fun experience with the fact that these are animals, you know?
I'm laughing out loud every episode, which to me is a big deal in a comedy. Sometimes I'm just sort of smiling and that's a good show, but I'm laughing out loud. But at what?
One of my favorite jokes in the pilot is one that Gabby pitched when Honey tells Elsa she knows what time it is because she can smell.
Thanks, Jen.
Chief has a lot of dreams in throughout the season, and those are some of my favorite bits when, because it's just really random things that he's dreaming of, different food items, you know, different, like, I feel like, was there something about like a cable plan or something, or maybe that was
the bundle,
like those bits were always my favorite because they were just so completely isolated from everything else. They were just kind of like fun little random rants that he was dreaming about.
Yeah, John Levenstein wrote one where you were, where Chief was asking about the French horn and can customers play it?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
I really enjoyed, I'm not necessarily a specific joke, but there, at a certain point in the season, we get to see inside of like the hoarder's house that the Gray One lives in. And the stuff between the Gray One and the other cats that he lives with, and the without spoilers, guys, no spoilers, because I know this is like a J.J. Abrams mystery box type show, so I don't want to give anything away. But we do know how this show ends. There's just a lot of stuff that happens in that house that is very surprising and hilarious to me. Mm-hmm. And that stuff, those are some of my favorite jokes are inside, for my character, are inside of when we go into his world and what that looks like compared to how all the other pets live. Like his right. life is markedly different in pretty bizarre and hilarious ways. And plus there's a polar bear and a hatch, you know? So what's in the hatch? I don't know.
I mean, there could be a polar bear on this show down the line. It's an animal. Like that'll give you.
Definitely, yeah.
That's Listen, true. Absolutely. We're talking to some pretty big names for the polar season two. Polar bear.
Pretty big polar bears have approached us. Yeah.
Sorry, Sam, did you
There
wanna...
are so many jokes that I love, but one of my favorite things is actually a visual thing of Chico angrily sitting on top of a Roomba as it goes around the room, and just his expression on the Roomba always makes me laugh.
I know things that make me laugh aren't necessarily about honey, aren't things that I say.
Okay, that's fair.
But no, it's just like, I think it's episode two, right? Where she's trying not to go outside because she doesn't like the way she looks and she has to poop, and one just flies across the room and hits her like a oop. That made me laugh out loud. It's duty.
There's this one joke where Chico goes, which to humans, it doesn't mean to a cat, that's the whole comedy.
And also, just for the people running the panel, if you could take those cat sounds that Sam just did and edit them into earlier in the panel when Sam couldn't produce a cat sound, like, when not at, well, unprompted, Sam crushes. I've asked if Sam will just dub all of my cat sounds, because I am terrible at cat sounds. Whenever we're recording, we have to like Google cat sounds just so I can make them. Sam has them ready to go.
Oh yeah, I talk to these cats nonstop.
That's actually a really interesting point, and you're probably half joking, but at the same time, what was the philosophy here on the animal noises? How much of it had to come from the actors versus like fully?
We're sort of tweaking it now in the editing. We use primarily the actor voices, because when they're making their cat sounds, their animal sounds, it really fits with the character. So it's perfect. It's great. The only time we've really used actual animal sounds so far in like extreme situations, like when Jason's character, the Gray One, is in a fight with a raccoon, and those sounds have to be like a little bit more intense than a human can probably produce. I don't know. So we've used it then. Gabby, are there any other times?
Sometimes the coyote, there's a coyote that is, you know, hot for honey, and he lurks around. His mating call, we've tried to find something a little more animalistic for him, but we also use some of his howling. So I would say that's really the only, the rest of them we really like to have the actors do. It's just, it sounds better. It sounds more like them, like their character. And it's just funnier, you know, it feels more organic that it's their voices.
So aside from Jason, everybody was able to do those sounds.
Jason said he'd take Gus's workshop.
Gus
has a workshop that Jason has attended. So
I have signed up. Yeah, I'm doing the second round of Sam's cat Gus's workshop about finding your inner pussy cat.
This whole cast fulfills a lot of needs for you, Jason.
Honestly, if this show goes away, I'm fucked.
Oh, I was gonna say, I mean, that's a great place, I think, to end it, because season two, more cat sounds from Jason is what I'm hearing.
So, what? More?
Fingers crossed for season two. Well, thank you guys all for joining us at the ATX Television Festival panel for Housebroken.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.